Today, we're going to talk about the pupil of the eye. That's the black hole in the center, surrounded by the iris. What's interesting about the pupil is its size varies, and so we have to control it with our nerves and our central nervous system. So what I want to do now is to look for the structures in the brain that control the size of the pupil. Pupillary constriction is a little bit complicated because we have to remember that this cranial nerve 3 carries somatic motor fibers to the eye muscles and eyelid, but it also carries autonomic fibers to smooth muscle. So the muscles that constrict and dilate the pupil are under autonomic control, and the constrictor fibers for the muscles of the iris are in the third nerve, and the fibers that are for dilation of the pupil come through the sympathetic nervous system, which we'll discuss later. The pupillary light reflex involves the cranial nerve here, seen on a mid-sagittal section. This is the right hemisphere. Here is the chiasm. So information coming in from one optic nerve is going to go to the nuclei on both parts of the brainstem. And this reflex is a brainstem. This is midbrain. So this is a midbrain reflex. You do not need the cerebral cortex for this reflex. Therefore, it's very useful in testing the integrity of the central nervous system in a patient who is unconscious. Now, let's look at a horizontal section. So here we have an axial or horizontal section, and it takes us through the optic tract here. Remember, behind the chiasm that was here is the optic tract. And the optic tract is coming in here, but let's get oriented first. Here is the frontal lobe, the occipital lobe, the temporal lobe, and here is the midbrain sitting in the center. The ventricles are easily seen, and we can see the mammillary bodies, the cerebral peduncles, substantia nigra, and aqueduct of the midbrain, and another important structure, the area of the superior colliculus here. Now, our optic tract on either side is going to go around, you can see it almost here, goes around the cerebral peduncle, and we've already talked about the fibers that went to the lateral geniculate. But there are some axons, fibers, that bypass the lateral geniculate and go up here to the region of the superior colliculus, a region near the midbrain that is called the pretectal region. Remember that the superior and inferior colliculi together are called the tectum. And so this is where there are interneurons for our pupillary light reflex. Those interneurons connect with a nucleus underneath the aqueduct. The nucleus is called the ocular motor nucleus. And right next to it is the Edinger-Westphal nucleus. The Edinger-Westphal nucleus contains the neurons for the autonomic nervous system. Remember, the autonomic nervous system is a two-neuron system. It's going to go out and synapse on a ganglion in the orbit, the ciliary ganglion, and the second neuron is going to go out to the smooth muscle to cause constriction of the pupil. So that's the anatomical pathway. In, synapse, and then out through the third nerve, which unfortunately is missing on this brain. Let's look at it in another view. Now I want to show you an animation that shows this circuitry with the afferent information coming in from the optic nerve and the efferent motor information coming out through the Edinger-Westphal nucleus, the third cranial nerve, out to the ciliary body, and out to the smooth muscle of the pupil. We've spoken about the pupillary light reflex, which involves cranial nerves 2 and 3, and is a reflex at the level of the midbrain. But now we're going to talk about pupillary dilatation, which really isn't just a reflex, but more of a response that involves neurons beginning in the hypothalamus and that continue down through the brainstem, through the midbrain, through the pons, and through the medulla, onto the spinal cord, where they're going to end on preganglionic sympathetic neurons. As they come down to the cord, to this high thoracic level, they pass through both the pons and the medulla, as you can see here. Upon reaching the cord, the second neuron, the preganglionic sympathetic neuron, exits through the ventral roots to the side sympathetic chain ganglion and ascends through the thorax to the superior cervical ganglion. And from there, the next neuron, the postganglionic sympathetic neuron, forms a plexus that ascends along the carotid artery and goes up into the cranium and then back out with some other nerves, traveling on other nerves into the orbit to finally terminate on the smooth muscle of the iris. And this results in pupillary dilatation, the radial muscles of the iris. Taking careful notice of the pupil size is important when you're doing the examination. Notice that in the top diagram, there is asymmetry between the pupils, and the right pupil is dilated. This is typically seen with trauma or damage or other kinds of lesions to the third or ocular motor nerve, interrupting the parasympathetic innervation of the constrictor muscle of the pupil. Now, this condition is usually associated also with a droopy eyelid or ptosis, which is not illustrated here. The next one is bilateral dilated pupils, and this happens when you have midbrain injury. When the midbrain is compressed, the temporal lobes put pressure onto the third nerve, usually bilaterally, but it can be unilateral. And also it presses on the midbrain reticular formation, which can cause drowsiness, stupor, and coma. This is a big emergency. So bilateral dilated or blown pupils is an important thing to pick up and notice. This often occurs without any droop in the eyelid, and often you are examining an unconscious patient and have to lift the eyelids to see this condition. And finally, the small pinpoint pupils are typical of lesions in the pons, damaging those descending hypothalamic spinal fibers, or you can see it with a Horner syndrome. This condition of pinpoint pupils is also seen with opiate abuse or administration. Remember that examination of the pupils is very important, and pinpoint pupils, when it's central, is most often associated with damage to the pons. Let's look at a diagram of the pathway involved in a condition called Horner's syndrome. Horner's syndrome consists of three clinical signs: meiosis, ptosis, and anhidrosis. Meiosis is a constricted pupil due to the unopposed action of the ocular motor nerve, which results in constriction. Ptosis, which is very subtle and minor due to a small smooth muscle in the eyelid, not nearly as pronounced as a ptosis due to third nerve damage. And anhidrosis is a loss of sweating on the face due to loss of innervation of the sweat glands. As you can see from this picture, this is a long and tortuous course. And so when you see Horner's syndrome, you have to think of the entire central nervous system. You have to think of the sympathetic outflow out through the sympathetic chain, up through the thoracic cavity and the superior cervical ganglion, wandering up along the internal carotid artery and out into the orbit. And it's your job to decide where the problem is. The X marks a spot in the medulla where damage to the medulla due to usually a vascular lesion of either the vertebral artery or the posterior inferior cerebellar artery can present with a Horner's syndrome. The symptoms of Horner's syndrome are ipsilateral. They're on the same side of the body as the lesion. I don't want to leave the subject of the brain and the third nerve without making one important clinical point, and that is that this third nerve runs over this groove here in the uncus of the temporal lobe. And when you have increased intracranial pressure, like with a hemorrhage or a stroke or a tumor or swelling, that third nerve gets compressed. And one of the earliest things you see is loss or slowing of the pupillary light reflex. So pressure on the third nerve in an unconscious patient or a patient who is losing consciousness and becoming more comatose, then you want to think of midbrain compression. And what's in the midbrain? The midbrain, where the third nerve has its centers for control, is also the center of the reticular activating system. This is what keeps you conscious. Damage to this area leads to coma, and if the damage is irreversible, it leads to irreversible coma. So pressure on the midbrain by the temporal lobes, my thumbs here in this case, pushing will end up giving you loss or sluggish pupil response. It can be unilateral or bilateral. So that's an important take-home message from today, too. So now that you understand the pupil response, which is really important for testing the integrity, the functioning of the midbrain, with cranial nerve 3 and 2 being the reflex cranial nerves that you're testing, now you understand that we can go on to something a little more complicated called accommodation, or the near response, or the near triad. Accommodation is when you focus on something. I'm focusing on this probe, and there are three things that happen when my eyes accommodate to bring this into focus. The first thing is that my medial recti, controlled by the third nerve, both are active and move medially. The second thing that happens is that to restrict the stray light rays, my pupil constricts, narrows down so that the light rays don't dissipate and strike areas of the retina that are not needed. And then the third thing that happens is that the lens inside my eyeball changes its curvature. Its curvature increases so that the light rays are focused on the macula of the eye. Let's look at a very clever animation from the University of Toronto, which shows this much better than I can.
First, as an object approaches, both eyes track it in a process called convergence. The size of the eyes in this example has been greatly exaggerated so that the subtle movement that takes place during convergence can be seen. Convergence of the eyes keeps the image of the object of interest centered on the fovea, the part of the retina where resolution is highest. If the eyes do not converge appropriately, diplopia, or double vision, occurs. Second, the pupil must constrict to restrict the entry of light rays diverging from a near object, since diverging rays cannot be bent enough by the periphery of the lens to make them fall on the fovea. If the pupil were to remain dilated, the image would be blurred. Finally, the shape of the lens must change, increasing its refractive index so that the light rays passing through it converge on the fovea. In distance vision, the lens is pulled at its equator by the suspensory ligament, so that it is relatively thin. When the muscles of the ciliary body contract, the tension on the suspensory ligament decreases, and this allows the lens to assume a rounder shape, increasing its power to bend light. As a result, the image is focused on the fovea. Combined convergence, pupillary constriction, and rounding up of the lens all function to keep an object in focus as it approaches the eye.